Now, once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to The World Over. Last year, I brought you an interview with Jerry Lewis that made headlines around the world. He discussed his life, his incredible career, and he revealed things he had never disclosed before. Well, tonight, Jerry returns to talk about turning 90, and he's marking the milestone with a starring role in a new film, Max Rose. Lewis was first-time director Daniel Noah's only choice for the role, as they told a crowd at the Museum of Modern Art in New York recently.
They said, who do you want to play Max? And I said, I'm completely obsessed with Jerry Lewis playing this part.
I visited Jerry Lewis at his home in Las Vegas recently, surrounded by memorabilia from his storied career. Lewis is moving a little bit slower these days, but he is still entertaining, snappy, and in this interview, as moving as ever. We discussed how age has changed his process and why he came out of retirement for Max Rose. Here's my exclusive interview with the indomitable Jerry Lewis.
Tell us when to go.
Go.
Now?
Now. We're on. Look, a lot has happened since we last saw each other, last November. You hit a major milestone, 90 years old.
Yeah.
Which you call a monster number.
Oh, it's a monster number, all right.
Okay, so what's it like on the other side of 90?
Nothing.
Nothing.
You don't think about it until you try to walk.
Then you think about it often.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. What do you hate and love about it, being 90? There has to be a good part.
Oh, the good part is making it.
Beats the alternative.
You bet. Well, what happens is you flash on your life, and it's just a flash. But in that flash, there's days and months and hours. And it's amazing at what comes to the fore when you're thinking 90.
Singing in the rain. What a glorious feeling. I'm happy again. I'm singing in the rain. Singing in the rain.
Walk on with hope in your heart, and you'll never, no, you'll never walk alone. You'll never walk alone.
When I was 88, I started to feel the 90 effect. And you're torn between isn't that wonderful? And 90. And what you do a lot is you're thanking God quietly for the gifts, because I think it's a gift. According to the census in this country, there's not a lot of people that make 90.
Right.
So you start out with gratitude. And with making sure you don't forget the blessings. But I get out of the shower, I look at a long, full-length mirror, and I say, look at that. And I'm looking in the mirror, and I'm saying, he made 90, but look at him. He looks 90 in this mirror. And then I laugh at it. You have to laugh at it. Don't bitch so much. Be aware that everyone is watching the 90-year-old. The interesting thing to me, and the joy of doing this thing with Ray, is you get reminded of stuff you forgot. And that's what I love best about it, being reminded.
You know, as I was looking back on your career, and I've rewatched so many of your movies over the last week or two.
You got a lot of courage.
No, I don't. I laughed a lot, and my children did too, and their friends did as well, because we watched some of them as a group.
How old are they?
Well, I have a 17-year-old, a 12-year-old, and a 10-year-old. So imagine these kids watching your movies.
What are you, Catholic?
Yeah, I'm practicing. I haven't perfected it. I'm just practicing. But I'm amazed looking at you. You've reached 90. Most 90-year-olds, that's it.
Yeah.
They're not doing anything else. Jerry, you're on the road. You've got a new movie coming out. And I want to talk about that film, because I think there's a connection between your very earliest films and your whole body of work and this new film, Max Rose.
Well, you can go from my first film to Max Rose. You can go from that to that, and you will not get anything alike.
But there is a through line.
You have to set your mind and your body to the new film, whatever the film is. And that's what I've done all of my career. Get set for this upcoming film. And Max Rose is an unusual film for Jerry Lewis.
I'll say.
There's none of the pratfalls. No. He doesn't walk into a wall, hang himself with a telephone cord. And being put in that position of having to check all of those items is a joy. It's not a problem.
Ava and I were married 65 years. I can't even remember my life without her. But the truth is, her life with me was a lie.
Has something happened between you and Mom that you haven't told me or anyone?
I wanted to ask you here because I thought it was really important for you to have some social interaction with your peers.
Max is a piano player.
Can you play the blues?
I live the blues.
For 20 years, you didn't act. And then you get this script one day. Why did you take this role? It's a very different character for Jerry Lewis.
Well, the difference is, if Jerry Lewis is going to do another film, which is what's happening, he better have some reason, because without the reason, then you're just doing a film.
Yep.
But the reason in this case was that I fell in love with the script. And Daniel wrote from his heart.
One final film.
And it's good to go there once in a while. You learn a lot about yourself. It's kind of touch and go. And that they can't take away from me, because that's part of what I do. And I take advantage of the fact that the viewers have seen me before.
Well, that's part of the power of this piece. Yeah. Here is this performer, this film auteur that we've known our whole lives, And in this film, we don't just watch Jerry entertain us. We watch him reveal a part of himself and us and our journey. When you said every film has to have a reason,
yeah.
What was your reason for doing this film?
It's almost like saying goodbye, but I'm going to do it like a gentleman. Mm. And I fell in love with the writing. And Daniel wrote, unbeknownst to himself, he wrote a brilliant script. And to go out or to be closing in on the end of your career, you want it to be meaningful and not pie in the face and not water down your pants and not a slide through a glass door. This is just a man who is suffering from all of the ills that happen to you when you're 90. You don't walk so good, your sight is going, you don't hear very well. Mm-hmm. And you have to take what you get.
In Max Rose, you play a musician.
Right.
A man who's coping with obvious grief, missing mm-hmm. his wife, and then he discovers, it's a mystery also, he discovers a letter, an intimate letter from another man. And he's trying to pick up the pieces. Now, watching you play this man and going through his journey, I kept thinking to myself after watching all of your films, Jerry Lewis is a musician on many levels. In your body, if you watch your entire career, it's all music. Timing of the gags, the slapstick, and I know you as an editor, as a director, as an actor, it's all choreographed. How much of that did you rely on as you went to this role? A man who is having difficulty playing the things he once played. The body doesn't respond the way it did. Do you see a similarity in your life with that character?
Oh, yeah. And you have to respect it. You have to respect it because it's going to be there. Mm-hmm. You know, you have no guarantees of making 90.
Nope.
But there's a guarantee that all of the nonsense that comes with it, it will be there. Mm-hmm. You know that you're going to have to make some explanations. How come you live so long? Mm. There are people who will ask you, how the hell do I know? I got up, so I'm living. But I look around me, and I see the glory and the joy of what's been given to me with 90. You don't take the things that you're working on as infinite.
I spoke with Daniel Noah, and he said, you told him at one point, I know you're scared that I'm going to try to take over your movie. I will not do that. He said you didn't look at dailies. You didn't want to look into the monitor. Jerry Lewis, the man who founded Playback.
Yeah.
Why not? Why didn't you want to look at your performance?
Because there's two different people involved. Jerry and Jerry.
Explain the two Jerrys for us.
Well, you're sitting with the older 90-year-old.
Is the other the kid?
It's always the kid, yeah. He's always there. Mm-hmm. But there are times when you don't want to use him. Mm-hmm. And there are times when you need him. Mm-hmm. And you better use him. That's to save your ass because you screwed up over there. And it gets complicated. And frustrating, because you want to get to it sooner rather than later. Mm. And at 90, you're really working at a dangerous level because you can't guarantee you'll be here Thursday. You have to watch what you're doing and why you're doing it.
Thank you.
There are homages scattered throughout Max Rose, tips of the hat to moments that define Lewis's storied career. The famous pantomime to Count Basie's Cute from Cinderfella. And here he is in Max Rose.
You got it.
Lewis sings the tender song Somebody in Max Rose.
Oh, it's wonderful to care for somebody. And the most you have to give is your love.
But he sang that song first.
In a cabin.
In 1960.
Or a castle. Even though you rise or fall. Without somebody, you're nobody.
You're nobody at all.
There are flashes of the kid in this movie, flashes of him. I almost saw them as memorials and remembrances of so many of your performances from the past. They're interjected in, they're very natural, but they're there. But then I was struck by the stillness of this performance, Jerry. You have never been this still, I think, at any point in your cinematic career.
No, I never have.
Was it difficult?
Yeah.
How did you pull it off?
By not worrying about it. Meet it when it meets you and take care of it. Mm-hmm. That's it.
You went to deep places here that I have not seen. I mean, people mention King of Comedy, mm-hmm. and that is a great dramatic role. But you don't plunge the depths that you do in this movie.
No, because the depths that you're plunging into in this one are almost natural. Hmm. They're coming to you.
Yeah, the things you're dealing with in life.
Max Rose came to me at a time when I didn't think I would do a film. Huh. And that's what really excited me.
You told me once when we were last together about seeking your father's approval. You would show him your films and say, did you like it? Did you like it? And he said, it's okay. And you said, what do I have to do to get your approval? And he said, when you do a performance from here and not here, then you'll get my approval. Have you done that performance with Max Rose?
I think so. I think my dad will be proud of the fact that we've gone another way with the guy that will go another way. Then, on the other hand, there are times when I want to go for it and it ain't there. Hmm. It ain't coming.
Is that frustrating?
Frustrating.
You want to kill somebody.
Did you ever see somebody eat wallpaper?
Frequently, yeah. I've seen a lot of your movies.
Yeah, right. You got it. You got it.
Daniel said you shared with him that you believed your father sent this script to you.
It made him feel good.
So you didn't believe your father sent this to you?
I don't believe he read it.
Yeah, but it was an opportunity for you. Mm-hmm. To do a very different type of character.
Right.
And to show us a different part of Jerry Lewis than we've ever seen on screen.
And hoping that my father didn't say, stop, that's not him.
You took the offer.
It's like Annie said, this place is very, very expensive.
You selfish little putz!
Okay. Great to see you, as always.
Who'd you sell it to? One of your big shot friends? No, maybe you bought it for yourself so you could go and get another wife and a bunch of kids that you don't take care of.
I take care of my kids.
Like you cared for Annie?
I care about you, Pop. I don't want to fight.
I don't need you to care for me.
Okay. We got to deal with this.
Deal with what?
I'm not angry at you, Pop. I love you. Okay?
I love you. You try to say it. I love you.
I've seen what you do to people you love.
You're quoted as saying, after the first time you watched the film, you were very quiet, and you said, I never saw him that way before. What did you mean by that?
I'd never seen him that way before.
Him meaning you.
Mm-hmm. When you watch Jerry and Max Rose, you can see him struggling.
Uh-huh.
And looking at him, he's working for you and for me.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very silent and very quiet. You must never, ever give up on your responsibility, and that is to entertain the people.
Right.
When you get deep enough into looking at the material and seeing yourself in it, mm-hmm. I keep getting this loud, noisy bastard coming up. No, out. Next.
We love that loud, noisy bastard.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Phew.
And he's convoluted. Hmm. He's complicated.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he has the ability of bringing his personal feelings to a scene.
Mm-hmm.
And will it make the scene better? Not always. He's screwed up many scenes that way. Mm. But on the whole, it's great that he is that analytical.
Yeah. People don't want to talk about death, Jerry. They don't want to talk about getting old. Why did you think it was important for you to do a film about a man who gets old and moves toward death?
Well, it's very nice to have happen on the screen. That's really happening in real life. Mm-hmm. And it's the end of my career. You know, I have to respect that. And I have to respect that audiences will see that.
Mm-hmm.
You have to lighten it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't go to the blackest mark. Go right. to the next to the blackest mark. Mm-hmm. Ego comes into it.
Mm-hmm.
Vanity comes into it. All the things that you never, ever allow an audience to see on purpose.
Yeah.
But then you can forget it all when you get on the set in the character.
When I watched it, I thought, this is a brave man. But no, because it would be very easy for you
to lay back.
To do what so many other comedians have done, which is they do a little cameo, they do what they're known for, and they go away. Rodney Dangerfield was Rodney Dangerfield in every movie Rodney Dangerfield ever did. Buster right. Keaton was Buster Keaton in
yes.
every movie. Jerry Lewis has done something here that is scary.
Oh, I've scared audiences for years.
I don't mean that. I mean going to those places that none of us want to wrestle with. None of us want to wrestle with getting old and losing the ones we love and contending with all of that. To going into a home. This is the man who brought that little girl in the family jewels, and he gives her a family. And here we see the little girl putting him in an old folks home. That's a big journey
mm-hmm.
for an actor and for an audience. Did you consciously say, this is the journey I'm going to take them on?
No. I had to stay very, very solidly ensconced in the role so that I don't do that,
mm-hmm.
so that this doesn't take me to a place that shouldn't be taken at that time.
Right. But you as a performer, you as an actor, had to make a decision when you first got that script. You knew what that story was about. They don't want to talk about getting old. They don't want to talk about losing anybody. They don't want to think about death.
But there's a lot of people that do. They do. They go to my movie so they don't have to face it themselves.
Mm. And now you're taking them there.
Yeah. You're just escorting them.
Why?
Because they won't go by themselves.
And do you think about death now that you're 90?
All the time.
Does it scare you?
Mm-hmm. Because I know the finish. Mm. You don't. Mm-hmm. I do. I don't know the specific finish, mm-hmm. but I will tell you that that's where it goes.
Yeah.
And then you're saddened by the fact that you got it so perfect. Mm. Why do I want to be perfect finishing? Mm. Well, because a true actor will go back to where it was terrific as often as he can go. Till the director says, we've shot that three times.
There's a beautiful monologue about dreams
right.
that I found out from your director. He didn't write. You improvised.
Right. Which I did a lot of. But that was not in the character. What I did a lot of was Jerry sneaking into the role.
Mm.
So that I never lose him. I never, ever wanted to lose him. I want to put him on hold. Huh. Until I really need a heavy hit. Mm-hmm. And that's part of what Jerry's magic was. An audience never knew where he was going.
Uh-huh.
And he didn't know a lot of times. And he had the courage to go for it anyway. And he trusts his instinct. He trusts it like crazy. And if it works, he'll trust it again. You cannot overdo perfect. Huh. If you do perfect, leave it alone.
Welcome to Surefoot County. You were zipping right through that like you were a land-to-air missile. Would I be too pushy, sir, if I asked for your license, please?
I'm sorry, officer. I don't have my license.
You don't have your license with you. How about that? I'm going to have to ask you to step out of that car. Step right out of that car. That's a fine car. Right out of that car. Now, slow and spread them. Turn around and spread them, man. Just spread them. Get those hands up there. I'm checking out. I spread. I just got it.
Listen. Try this.
There are girls just ripe for some kissing, and I mean to kiss me a few.
Do you think that's why the audience has stuck by you all these years? Because you just said it. He trusts his instincts, but he doesn't even know where he's going. We don't either.
That's not always the case, but in many cases, it is. And he trusts it. He mm-hmm. feels comfortable in being totally stupid. Mm-hmm. And stupid, though it is looked upon as a negative, stupid so often can answer questions. Mm. Where people don't want to go because you're announcing you're stupid.
Yeah. Is this a comeback or a swan song for you?
Comeback? I did 63 films. I only had time to look at the coming attractions.
But you haven't done a film in 20 years, Jerry.
That's what you think.
Ah. Uh-oh. Wait a minute.
I make a film out of this day. in here. Mm-hmm. That if I ever need it, I'm prepared.
Uh-huh. Can I watch some of those with you sometime?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. This is also a movie about relationships and marriage.
Yeah.
What did you come away with after playing this role? And how did it change at all your perception of those bonds that we make early in life that you continue and that take you to the very end?
I used my life as a wonderful reference point. I tried to take what I felt with my wife and extend it for the run of the film. But I am a very, very unusual man. I could spend probably 10 or 20 hours explaining to you what my Sam meant to the film.
It's such a revealing portrait of Max Rose, absolutely.
Yeah.
But also of the Jerry Lewis I've come to know.
Right.
Who is a vulnerable man, and the world has this vision of you as this
crazy, well, nuts.
Crazy, demanding, difficult. That's not the Jerry I've encountered. I mean, there's shades of that. Let me not run away, but hey, catch me on a wrong day and I'll show you my ugly side. But I loved that you were willing to show that vulnerability and risk showing that to a world that may or may not accept it.
No, you have to do that. You must do that because that's part of your integrity.
You know what I thought about? I was just lying there listening to you breathe. And I never told you, Ava, but you breathe nicer than anyone I've ever known in my life. And I'm thinking to myself, we've had 65 years together, but we never figured how old we were together. Do you know how
old? That's because my arithmetic, sir.
We're 169 years old.
Each?
No, not each. Both of us
together.
Really? 169 years old.
It's a hell of a long time. Yeah. I wish we'd been together 169 years. That would have been great.
Claire Bloom was your wife in the piece. Tell me about working with Claire Bloom.
You aren't working with Claire Bloom. You were assisting Claire Bloom.
How so?
Just be there on time, mm-hmm. know the words, and help her be better. But when we weren't rehearsing the scene, we were talking about Charlie.
Claire Bloom worked with comic legend Charlie Chaplin in his 1952 film, Limelight.
Charlie Chaplin was a major influence on you. You went to meet him. You met him in Switzerland?
2 days.
Wow.
Of 2 weeks, we just talked.
Huh.
And in his discussion with me, he would refer to me as the newest catalyst. And he was very impressed with how impressed I was.
Huh.
And I'm talking to the man about the man.
Wow. Now you know how I feel.
Touché.
That's right. Now you know how I feel.
Well, that's a great compliment. Thank you.
I want to thank you for this glorious performance in Max Rose. And for revealing so much of yourself to us and on the screen in the film.
Thank you. I enjoy being with you because you bring intelligence to why we're sitting down. And well, I like that.
Well, you bring out the best in me. And I love you like so many others watching.
Thank you, Ray.
Max Rose, starring Jerry Lewis, is in theaters nationally. Check your local listings. It's really a quite tender movie about the things that matter. It also marks the conclusion of an iconic career. And by the way, Jerry was very sure to tell me, as I left, that he's doing his live show through October.